Welcome back, students. This is the second lecture in the chapter of magnetism. In the previous chapter, we had studied about some few basic terms and definitions related to magnetism. And we also introduced to what creates magnetism in a material, that is the origin of magnetization. Okay. So now in this lecture and further lectures, we'll be dealing with different types of magnetic materials. Magnetic materials can be classified based on how they behave when you apply a external magnetic field to them. Okay, so we'll see that. So based on this behavior in the external magnetic field, materials can be classified into diamagnetic materials, paramagnetic materials, and ferromagnetic materials. So we're going to see in brief in the first part here. We are briefly going to cover up all these three things, and then further we are going to take each of these magnetic materials slightly more in details. So the first type of magnetic material is a diamagnetic material. So what is a diamagnetic material? It is a material which, suppose you apply a magnetic field in one direction. So we have a material here. And suppose you apply magnetic field in this direction, H in this direction. The material gets magnetized weakly, a very weak magnetization is created inside the material, but in the opposite direction. So magnetization in the material occurs in the reverse direction compared to the applied magnetic field. So such materials are called as diamagnetic materials. So you can see here, magnetization in direction opposite to the applied magnetizing field. Another way by which you can determine whether the material is diamagnetic is by taking a permanent magnet. If you bring a magnet close to a diamagnetic material, this material will be repelled by the magnet. So there is a weak repulsion which is created by a magnet to diamagnetic substances. So diamagnetic substances are weakly repelled by a magnet. Examples of diamagnetic materials are bismuth, copper, lead, zinc, tin, gold, silicon, water, sodium chloride, and many more, but these are some commonly we encounter in our day-to-day life. These are some common examples of diamagnetic material. Remember, water, which we consume every day, is also diamagnetic in nature. So if you have a very strong magnet and you have a very tiny drop of water, if you bring a very strong magnet close to a drop of water, you will see the water droplet being slightly repelled by this magnet. The next type of materials are paramagnetic materials. So what happens here? Suppose you have a paramagnetic material and suppose you apply a magnetic field in this direction, H is applied in this direction, then the material gets magnetized in the same direction as the applied field, but very weakly. Just like a diamagnetic material, the magnetization produced in the material is very small, very weak, but in the case of paramagnetic, the material gets magnetized in the same direction as the applied field. So, and if you take a magnet close to such materials, they will be weakly attracted. You will not feel a strong attraction there, very, very weak attraction. So compared to diamagnetic material, paramagnetic materials are weakly attracted by magnets. Examples are manganese, aluminium, chromium, platinum, sodium, copper, chloride, oxygen. The oxygen which we breathe also is slightly paramagnetic in nature. The third type of material is ferromagnetic material. So ferromagnetic materials are also somewhat like paramagnetic, but the only difference between paramagnetic and ferromagnetic is that the magnetization created in the object is very large. So if I apply a magnetic field H in this direction, the magnetization produced in the object will be quite large, sorry, in the same direction, not opposite, same direction, but it's very large. The magnetization produced is very large. Compared to magnetization in paramagnetic material, the magnetization produced in ferromagnetic material when you place it in the external magnetic field is very large. Okay? So strong magnetization in the direction of the applied magnetizing field. And they are strongly attracted by magnets. Examples are, the most common example of a ferromagnetic material is iron. You know that when we take iron close to a magnet, it is strongly attracted by a magnet. Other examples are cobalt, nickel, gadolinium, and other alloys of such materials. Okay, Alnico, for example, is an alloy of aluminium, nickel and cobalt. This also is ferromagnetic in nature. So these are the pure elements which are ferromagnetic, and then combining many of these materials you can get the various alloys which are also ferromagnetic in nature. So these are the three types of magnetic materials: diamagnetic, paramagnetic and ferromagnetic. Now what we'll be doing is we'll be going little bit in details of each of these materials and study their properties also. First we'll be talking about the diamagnetic materials. So how do we know that what type of materials exhibit diamagnetism? It is found that materials having atoms with even number of electrons in them, 4, 8, 6, 10, total number of electrons in the atom, if there are even number, then mostly these elements exhibit diamagnetism. But what happens over there is that the electronic orbits, the shells, S, P, D, F shells, they are completely filled, and so what happens is that the net spin cancels out, the overall spin cancels out. So if one electron is filled with a spin in upward direction, there is another electron also which pairs up with it with a spin in the opposite direction. So both spins cancel out, and the entire, this happens in the entire P shell or the D shell. So entire shell is completely filled and the filling occurs with oppositely paired electrons. So the net spinning, the net magnetic moment of the atom becomes zero. So that's the reason why only even number of atoms with only even number of electrons mostly exhibit this diamagnetic property, because only when the electrons are completely paired up, only then net magnetization, magnetic dipole moment of the atom will be zero, and therefore they can exhibit a diamagnetic nature. So one important property of diamagnetic materials therefore is that the atoms to begin itself, they do not have any magnetic moment. You can see in this thing here, the entire magnetic moment itself is cancelled out. So starting with the tiniest particle in the material, the atom itself doesn't possess a magnetic moment to begin with. Then what happens? Therefore, in the absence of magnetic field, you can see inside these atoms, there is no arrow shown there. Okay, there is no magnetic dipole present in any of the atoms. So in the absence of magnetic field, all the atoms are unmagnetized. Okay, they do not possess any dipole moment. But now when you place this material, diamagnetic material, in a external magnetic, what happens is that the orbital motion of the electrons undergo changes. So the electrons which are moving with a particular speed, they are slowed down or their speed is increased in such a way that a magnetic moment is induced in the atoms in a direction opposite to the applied magnetic field. So when you place such a diamagnetic material, diamagnetic atom in a magnetic field, the orbital of motion of the electron is either increased or decreased in such a way that because of this change in the orbital motion of the electron, in the atom there is a magnetic moment which is induced. And by Lenz's law, as per Lenz's law, this direction of the magnetic moment must be opposing the applied magnetic field. So if you apply the magnetic field in this direction, the changes occur in the atom in such a way that the magnetic moment which is induced in the atom is in the opposite direction. So you can see in this figure here, most of the atoms have gained a magnetization, a dipole moment in the opposite direction. So when you combine overall all this thing, the entire material itself shows a weak magnetization in the direction opposite to the applied magnetic field. So you apply magnetic field this way, the material gets magnetized in the opposite direction. So basically it is because of Lenz's law. To start with itself, the atom may not possess any magnetic moment, but because of the magnetic field applied, the material, the atoms gain a magnetic moment, but the Lenz's rule requires that the magnetic moment should be in such a direction that it should oppose the thing which is creating it. What is creating the magnetic moments there? It's the applied field. So if the applied field is creating the magnetic moments, the magnetic moments according to Lenz's law must be in the opposite direction. They should oppose the thing which is creating the magnetic moments, that is the applied magnetic field. So that is how, based on Lenz's law, we can explain the phenomena of diamagnetism, wherein you apply magnetic field in one direction, the material gets magnetized weakly in the opposite direction. A few properties of diamagnetic materials. First one, as I already told you, in the absence of magnetic field, the atoms by themselves do not possess any dipole moment. Okay? They do not, because the electron spins cancel out, so the atoms by themselves do not have any permanent dipole moment. They weakly repel magnetic lines of force. You can see this figure here. If it is a diamagnetic material in a magnetic field, so in between two magnetic poles if you place it, the magnetic field lines will never pass through that diamagnetic material. Why? Because this diamagnetic material repels the magnetic field. It pushes it away from the interiors of the body. So the magnetic field lines are pushed away from the object. No magnetic line of force can pass within a diamagnetic material. Third thing, the magnetic susceptibility chi is negative and it has a small value. Now why is it negative? Because if you remember this relation, M is equal to chi times H. Right? Now if you see the, so what will be chi? Chi will be M by H. Now, in a for a diamagnetic material, if you apply magnetic field in right direction, the magnetization is in the opposite direction. So how do we indicate that? So if you apply H in the positive direction, magnetization occurs in the negative direction, opposite direction. So there's a negative sign which comes there. So therefore, chi is minus M of H. So it is, chi is negative. So the magnetic susceptibility is negative because the magnetization is opposite compared to the applied magnetic field. Susceptibility is almost independent of temperature. So as you raise the temperature, also the value of chi for a diamagnetic material remains almost the same. Relative permeability is slightly less than 1. Mu r is slightly less than 1. Now why is this? Because if you remember, what is the value of mu r? Mu r is 1 plus chi. Okay? Now if chi is negative, a small value, it's a small value. Chi is negative and it is small. So if you remember, if you imagine 1 plus a small negative number, so it will be slightly less than 1. So in other words, you're subtracting a small number from 1. So the resultant will be a number slightly less than 1. So since chi is small and negative, the relative permeability, which is 1 plus chi, is slightly less than 1. And last thing, the magnetization M is a linear function of the applied magnetic field. So what it means is that, so if you plot a graph of M versus H, it will be almost a straight line. Okay, the graph, so the magnetization and that is linearly proportional to the applied magnetic field. So this is about diamagnetic materials. Next we'll discuss quickly about paramagnetic materials. So what is the structure, what is the configuration, atomic configuration for a paramagnetic material? For a paramagnetic material, just like the diamagnetic material, the shells are almost completely filled except for just one shell. You can see here, these shells are filled, these shells also are filled, whereas the last shell electron is unpaired. So therefore, this paramagnetism is mostly exhibited by atoms having odd number of electrons. Why? Because whenever the number is odd, one electron remains unpaired. So one shell, one electron when it remains unpaired, this unpaired electron contributes to a net magnetic moment of that atom. So even in the absence of a magnetic field, every atom possesses a very small magnetic moment because of only one unpaired electron present in the orbitals. So atoms, so it's unbalanced. So because of this one electron, it is unbalanced, and therefore the atoms possess a net magnetic moment even in the absence of a magnetic field. That is what is mentioned here. So even if the field is zero, if the applied field is zero, the atoms, individual atoms, they, you can see tiny arrows inside these atoms. Okay, there is an arrow here. The arrow indicates the direction of its magnetic moment. So every atom has a tiny magnetic moment associated with it. But what happens in the absence of a magnetic field, when there is no magnetic field applied, all these individual atomic dipoles, they are randomly oriented. So one is in this direction, other one is downwards, other one is towards the left and so on. So the directions are different. So as a result, when you see the overall net result in this entire material, its resultant is zero. So even though individual atoms possess a tiny magnetic moment, in the absence of a magnetic field, all these individual magnetic dipoles are in different directions, random directions, and hence the net magnetization is zero. What happens when you place a paramagnetic material in a magnetic field. Now when you place it in the magnetic field, you can see in this figure here, we have applied a magnetic field in this direction. What happens is, all the individual dipoles, individual atomic dipoles, they tend to move or tend to reorient themselves in the direction of the field. So most of them you can see, for example, this one, it was completely opposite to the direction. You have applied a field towards the right, but this one was pointing towards the left. So in the presence of the field, what happens? It's slightly rotated. It is not able to fully rotate. If you apply a very strong field, it also will fully rotate. But when a moderate field is applied, even this one, which is shown over here, it has not completely oriented itself in the direction of the field, it has rotated a little bit and tried to orient itself in the direction of the applied magnetic field. So this way, every atomic dipole little bit rotates in the direction of the applied magnetic field, and therefore now you find a resultant, most of the atomic dipoles are pointing almost in the direction of the applied magnetic field. So therefore there is a net magnetization created over here. Though it is small, but in the presence of applied magnetic field, a paramagnetic material shows a small magnetization because of the individual atomic dipoles tending to align in the direction of the applied field. So non-zero magnetization is produced in the direction of the field because the atomic dipoles are aligning in the same direction as the applied field. Now if the field is removed, the field is again removed, okay, what will happen? These atomic dipoles which had oriented in the direction of the field, they will come back to their original directions like this, come back to this original state, and now again in the original state they are in random directions, so the net magnetization again becomes zero. So magnetization of the material again becomes zero when the magnetic field is removed. So only in the presence of a magnetic field, external magnetic field, a paramagnetic material will get magnetized. Moment you remove the magnetization, the material returns to its original state and it becomes unmagnetized again. A few properties of a paramagnetic materials. They have permanent magnetic dipoles, so the atoms by default itself, even in the absence of a magnetic field, every individual atom has a small magnetic dipole because of the unpaired electron remaining in one of its orbitals. They are weakly attracted by magnetic lines of force. You can see in this figure here, when you place a paramagnetic material in a magnetic field, the magnetic lines of force are pulled within the material, but not to a very great extent. There is a weak pulling of the magnetic lines of force within the material. Okay, so they weakly attract magnetic lines of force. Susceptibility and positive and has a small value. Now why is susceptibility positive here? Because as we said, Ka is equal to M by H. So both M is positive, H also, H is, if you apply H in one direction, M is also created in the same direction. So therefore, M and H have both positive signs, so therefore Chi is positive. And it has a small value, why? Because only one unpaired electron contributes to the magnetization over there. So the magnetization is there, but is very weakly magnetized. So Chi is small. Susceptibility varies inversely with temperature. For diamagnetic materials, we had mentioned that susceptibility is independent, almost independent. Here, there is a inverse relation. So Chi and temperature, they have an inverse relation. Chi is inversely proportional to the temperature. So as you increase the temperature, the susceptibility of a paramagnetic material decreases. And here in this formula, you have to remember that T is the absolute temperature. So for example, in problems, if it comes, you have to put the value of T in Kelvin scale. If it is given in Celsius, you need to convert it into Kelvin scale. Relay permeability is mu r is slightly greater than 1. Okay, why is it greater than 1? Because mu r is 1 plus chi. And chi is what? It is positive and small value. So 1 plus a small positive number will give you a number slightly greater than 1. Last thing, magnetization is a linear function of magnetic field when field is not very strong. Okay, so if I plot a graph of magnetization M versus the applied magnetic field H, initially it will be a straight line, but then it will tend to slowly become non-linear. So for a small magnetic field supplied, when the applied field is less, the graph is almost a straight line. Okay, so linear curve. But later on, if you apply keep on increasing the magnetic field, the magnetization tends to become flatter. The last type of magnetic materials is the ferromagnetic materials. Now this, if you can see in the configuration of the atomic orbitals, electronic orbitals, almost most of the atomic orbitals are unpaired. Okay, and this thing occurs in a very few elements. Not all, not many elements exhibit this property, wherein you can see a 1, 2, 3, 4 electrons are unpaired. Compared to paramagnetic, only one electron shell was unpaired. Here there are 4 electronic shells which are unpaired. So all these 4 will contribute to a large magnetic dipole in the atom. So the atom itself, in the beginning, in the absence, or even in the absence of magnetic field, individual atom will have a large magnetic dipole. Why? Because there are many unpaired electrons present in it. Okay, so there is a great imbalance of electronic spin. So all these electronic spins contribute. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So it possesses unbalanced electronic spins to a large extent, and hence individual atoms possess a large magnetic dipole moment even in the absence of a applied magnetic field. And I told you a very few elements exhibit this, like nickel, iron and cobalt. They have the 4 shells which are unfilled. Many of the 4 F shells are unfilled, whereas 3 shells which are unfilled in case of nickel, iron and cobalt, whereas in gadolinium the 4F shells are unfilled. Okay, they have unpaired electrons. So because this unpaired, huge number of unpaired electrons, it creates a large magnetic dipole moment in the atoms. So in the absence of the magnetic field, the atomic dipoles are randomly oriented. So even just like paramagnetic materials, when you apply, when there is no applied field, these individual atoms, which are quite strong magnetic dipoles here, but they are in random direction. So the net result is that the net magnetization is zero. So the metal is said to be unmagnetized. So in this state, in the absence of to start with a fresh material, if no magnetic field is applied, all the individual magnetic dipoles inside are randomly oriented and the net magnetization is zero. But then, when you place such a material in a magnetic field, just like a paramagnetic metal, the individual magnetic dipoles try to align themselves in the direction of the applied field, and this creates a magnetization M in the direction of the magnetic field. But this magnetization M in the case of a ferromagnetic material is large compared to a paramagnetic material. Because remember, individual atomic dipoles in the case of ferromagnetic materials, they have a large dipole moment because of large number of unpaired electrons. So when in the presence of a magnetic field, all these large magnetic dipoles tend to align in the almost same direction, and that gives rise to a large magnetization in the material. So the material is now said to be magnetized. Okay, so large magnetization is in the direction of applied magnetic field is created in the material. A special thing about this ferromagnetic materials is that when the external field is now removed, so you start with the unmagnetized piece of material, all the dipoles are randomly oriented. You place in the magnetic field, the dipoles tend to align in the direction of the applied magnetic field. There is net magnetization in the material, so the material is now magnetized. Now you remove the magnetic field. What happens is that some of the atomic dipoles, instead of returning back to their original state, they remain in the same direction as they were in the magnetic field. So even after the magnetic field is removed, some of the atomic dipoles continue to remain in the same orientation. They do not go back to the original orientation. So what will happen is that when you remove the magnetic field, there will be still some magnetization remaining in the material. Why? Because most of the atomic dipoles have continued to remain in the same direction as in the presence of the applied magnetic field. So the material therefore behaves like a permanent magnet. You know, permanent magnets, you don't require to place them in a magnetic field. So even in the magnetic field, they exhibit magnetic properties. So ferromagnetic materials, when you place them in the magnetic field, they get magnetized. And when you remove the magnetic field, this object still remains as a magnet. Okay, it becomes a permanent magnet, which is not in the case of a paramagnetic. Paramagnetic materials, the moment you remove the magnetic field, they will come back to their original orientation, they will lose their magnetization. Whereas ferromagnetic materials, they retain their magnetization. A few properties. They have large permanent magnetic dipoles because large number of unpaired electrons present in the shells. They strongly attract magnetic lines of force. You can see there is a there is a collection, all the magnetic force, lines of force have crowded within a material very close to each other. So they are strongly attracted. So this shows that the magnetic lines of force are strongly attracted within the material. Susceptibility is large and positive. Susceptibility again is M upon H. Now this M is a very large value. In the case of a ferromagnetic material, M attains a very large value. Why? Because individual atomic dipoles have dipole moments. So the net magnetization is quite large in the presence of a applied magnetic field. So when M is large, for a given value of H, chi also attains a very large value. And it's positive. Why? Because it's the magnetization occurs in the same direction as the applied magnetic field. Now, ferromagnetic materials exhibit something called as this Curie temperature. This is something special about ferromagnetic materials. TC, Curie temperature TC. What is this Curie temperature? As you increase the temperature of a ferromagnetic material, at a certain point above a certain temperature called as the Curie temperature, the ferromagnetic material loses its ferromagnetic properties and it becomes like a paramagnet. Okay, so if you have a ferromagnetic material, if you constantly keep on heating it up, at a certain temperature, it will lose its ferromagnetic properties and it will behave like a paramagnet. So the temperature beyond which the ferromagnetic material loses its ferromagnetic properties and becomes a paramagnet, that temperature is called as the Curie temperature, denoted by the symbol TC. So beyond the temperature, ferromagnetic materials behave like paramagnetic substances. Susceptibility again has an inverse relation with the temperature. So chi is C divided by T minus TC. Here TC is the Curie temperature and T is the temperature, absolute temperature of the object, temperature in Kelvin scale. Now this relation holds only for T greater than TC. Okay? Chi is equal to C divided by T minus TC only for T greater than TC. If it is less than TC, we know that this relation will no longer hold. Why? Because for T less than TC, the material becomes a paramagnetic material. Next thing is relative permeability. Mu r is large and very much greater than 1. Mu r is 1 plus I. Mu r is 1 plus I. So what will happen is, since chi is very large, one plus chi will be a large number. So relative permeability for ferromagnetic materials is a very large quantity. They exhibit magnetization even in the absence of external magnetic field. So they exhibit what is permanent magnetization, okay? Permanent magnets. Magnetic field does not vary linearly with applied magnetic field. Okay, so if you plot a graph of M versus H, the graph will not be a straight line. It will be something like this. Okay, it varies as a curve, not as a straight line. They show hysteresis effect. We'll be studying what is this hysteresis in the next class. So they show hysteresis and they show also what is called as domain structure. So there are tiny regions in it called as domains, which again we'll be studying in the next class. So there are some few properties of ferromagnetic materials. So out of all the three metals, the one which shows the strongest magnetization are ferromagnetic materials. Okay, and they are the ones they are used for making permanent magnets. In they are also used for making cores in transformers, in the motors and all. So these are the ones which find very large applications in our day-to-day life. Thank you.